Chapter 10. Rome. Part 2. The carriages were now three abreast, in broader places four, often stationary for a long time together, always one close mass of variegated brightness, showing, the whole street full, through the storm of flowers, like flowers of a larger growth themselves. In some, the horses were richly caparisoned in magnificent trappings, in others they were decked from head to tail, with flowing ribbons. Some were driven by coachmen with enormous double faces, one face leering at the horses, the other cocking its extraordinary eyes into the carriage, and both rattling again, under the hail of sugar plums. Other drivers were attired as women, wearing long ringlets and no bonnets, and looking more ridiculous in any real difficulty with the horses, of which, in such a concourse, there were a great many, than tongue can tell, or pen describe. Instead of sitting in the carriages, upon the seats, the handsome Roman women, to see and to be seen the better, sit in the heads of the butchers, at this time of general license, with their feet upon the cushions, and oh, the flowing skirts and dainty waists, the blessed shapes and laughing faces, the free, good-humoured, gallant figures that they make. There were great vans, too, full of handsome girls, 30, or more together, perhaps, and the broadsides that were poured into, and poured out of all these fairy fire shops, splashed the air with flowers and bonbons for 10 minutes at a time. Carriages, delayed long in one place, would begin a deliberate engagement with other carriages, or with people at the lower windows, and the spectators at some upper balcony or window, joining in the fray, and attacking both parties, would empty down great bags of confetti, that descended like a cloud, and in an instant made them white as millers. Still, carriages on carriages, dresses on dresses, colors on colors, crowds upon crowds, without end. Men and boys clinging to the wheels of coaches, and holding on behind, and following in their wake, and diving in among the horses' feet to pick up scattered flowers to sell again, maskers on foot, the drollest generally, in fantastic exaggerations of court dresses, surveying the throng through enormous eyeglasses, and always transported with an ecstasy of love, on the discovery of any particularly old laddie at a window, long strings of polissinae, laying about them with blown bladders at the ends of sticks, a wagon full of madmen, screaming and daring to the life, a coach full of grave mamelukes, with their horse-tail standard set up in the midst, a party of gypsy women engaged in terrific conflict with a ship full of sailors, a man-monkey on a pole, surrounded by strange animals with pigs' faces, and lions' tails, carried under their arms, or worn gracefully over their shoulders, carriages on carriages, dresses on dresses, colors on colors, crowds upon crowds, without end. Not many actual characters sustained, or represented, perhaps, considering the number dressed, but the main pleasure of the scene consisting in its perfect good temper, in its bright, and infinite, and flashing variety, and in its entire abandonment to the mad humor of the time, an abandonment so perfect, so contagious, so irresistible, that the steadiest foreigner fights up to his middle in flowers and sugar plums, like the wildest Roman of them all, and thinks of nothing else till 4:30, when he is suddenly reminded, to his great regret, that this is not the whole business of his existence. By hearing the trumpets sound, and seeing the dragoons begin to clear the street. How it ever is cleared for the race that takes place at 5, or how the horses ever go through the race, without going over the people, is more than I can say. But the carriages get out into the by-streets, or up into the Piazza del Popolo, and some people sit in temporary galleries in the latter place, and tens of thousands line the Corso on both sides. When the horses are brought out into the Piazza, to the foot of that same column which, for centuries, looked down upon the games and chariot races in the Circus Maximus. At a given signal they are started off. Down the live lane, the whole length of the Corso, they fly like the wind, riderless, as all the world knows, with shining ornaments upon their backs, and twisted in their plaited manes, and with heavy little balls stuck full of spikes, dangling at their sides, to goad them on. The jingling of these trappings, and the rattling of their hoofs upon the hard stones. The dash and fury of their speed along the echoing street, nay, the very cannon that are fired, these noises are nothing to the roaring of the multitude, their shouts, the clapping of their hands. But it is soon over, almost instantaneously. More cannon shake the town. The horses have plunged into the carpets put across the street to stop them. The goal is reached, the prizes are won, they are given, in part, by the poor Jews, as a compromise for not running foot races themselves, and there is an end to that day's sport. But if the scene be bright, and gay, and crowded, on the last day but one, it attains, on the concluding day, to such a height of glittering color, swarming life, and frolicsome uproar, that the bare recollection of it makes me giddy at this moment. The same diversions, greatly heightened and intensified in the ardor with which they are pursued, go on until the same hour. The race is repeated. The cannon are fired, the shouting and clapping of hands are renewed. The cannon are fired again, the race is over, and the prizes are won. But the carriages, ankle deep with sugar plums within, and so beflowered and dusty without, as to be hardly recognizable for the same vehicles that they were 3 hours ago, instead of scampering off in all directions, throng into the Corso, where they are soon wedged together in a scarcely moving mass. For the diversion of the Moccoletti, the last gay madness of the carnival, is now at hand, and sellers of little tapers like what are called Christmas candles in England, are shouting lustily on every side, "Moccoli, Moccoli, Ecco Moccoli." A new item in the tumult, quite abolishing that other item of apostrophe Ecco Fiori, Ecco Fiorara, which has been making itself audible over all the rest, at intervals, the whole day through. As the bright hangings and dresses are all fading into one dull, heavy, uniform color in the decline of the day, lights begin flashing, here and there, in the windows, on the house tops, in the balconies, in the carriages, in the hands of the foot passengers, little by little, gradually, gradually, more and more, until the whole long street is one great glare and blaze of fire. Then, everybody present has but one engrossing object, that is, to extinguish other people's candles, and to keep his own alight, and everybody, man, woman, or child, gentleman or lady, prince or peasant, native or foreigner, yells and screams, and draws incessantly, as a taunt to the subdued, "Senza Moccolo, senza Moccolo." Without a light. Without a light, until nothing is heard but a gigantic chorus of those two words, mingled with peals of laughter. The spectacle, at this time, is one of the most extraordinary that can be imagined. Carriages coming slowly by, with everybody standing on the seats or on the box, holding up their lights at arm's length, for greater safety, some in paper shades, some with a bunch of undefended little tapers, kindled all together, some with blazing torches, some with feeble little candles, men on foot, creeping along, among the wheels, watching their opportunity, to make a spring at some particular light, and dash it out, other people climbing up into carriages, to get hold of them by main force, others, chasing some unlucky wanderer, round and round his own coach, to blow out the light he has begged or stolen somewhere, before he can ascend to his own company, and enable them to light their extinguished tapers, others, with their hats off, at a carriage door, humbly beseeching some kind-hearted lady to oblige them with a light for a cigar, and when she is in the fullness of doubt whether to comply or no, blowing out the candle she is guarding so tenderly with her little hand, other people at the windows, fishing for candles with lines and hooks, or letting down long willow wands with handkerchiefs at the end, and flapping them out, dexterously, when the bearer is at the height of his triumph, others, biding their time in corners, with immense extinguishers like halberds, and suddenly coming down upon glorious torches, others, gathered round one coach, and sticking to it, others, rining oranges and nosegays at an obdurate little lantern, or regularly storming a pyramid of men, holding up one man among them, who carries one feeble little wick above his head, with which he defies them all. Senza Moccolo. Senza Moccolo. Beautiful women, standing up in coaches, pointing in derision at extinguished lights, and clapping their hands as they pass on, crying, "Senza Moccolo! Senza Moccolo!" exclamation. Low balconies full of lovely faces and gay dresses, struggling with assailants in the streets, some repressing them as they climb up, some bending down, some leaning over, some shrinking back, delicate arms and bosoms, graceful figures, glowing lights, fluttering dresses. Senza Moccolo, senza Moccoli, senza Moccolo, oh oh oh. When in the wildest enthusiasm of the cry, and fullest ecstasy of the sport, the Avenue Maria rings from the church steeples, and the carnival is over in an instant, put out like a taper, with a breath. There was a masquerade at the theatre at night, as dull and senseless as a London one, and only remarkable for the summary way in which the house was cleared at 11 o'clock, which was done by a line of soldiers forming along the wall, at the back of the stage, and sweeping the whole company out before them, like a broad broom. The game of the Moccoletti, the word, in the singular, Moccoletto, is the diminutive of Moccolo, and means a little lamp or candle snuff, is supposed by some to be a ceremony of burlesque mourning for the death of the carnival, candles being indispensable to Catholic grief. But whether it be so, or be a remnant of the ancient Saturnalia, or an incorporation of both, or have its origin in anything else, I shall always remember it, and the frolic, as a brilliant and most captivating sight, no less remarkable for the unbroken good humour of all concerned, down to the very lowest. And among those who scaled the carriages, were many of the commonest men and boys, than for its innocent vivacity. For, odd as it may seem to say so, of a sport so full of thoughtlessness and personal display, it is as free from any taint of immodesty as any general mingling of the two sexes can possibly be, and there seems to prevail, during its progress, a feeling of general, almost childish, simplicity and confidence, which one thinks of with a pang, when the Avenue Maria has rung it away, for a whole year. Availing ourselves of a part of the quiet interval between the termination of the carnival and the beginning of the Holy Week, when everybody had run away from the one, and few people had yet begun to run back again for the other, we went conscientiously to work, to see Rome. And, by dint of going out early every morning, and coming back late every evening, and laboring hard all day, I believe we made acquaintance with every post and pillar in the city, and the country round, and, in particular, explored so many churches, that I abandoned that part of the enterprise at last, before it was half finished, lest I should never, of my own accord, go to church again, as long as I lived. But, I managed, almost every day, at one time or other, to get back to the Colosseum, and out upon the open Campagna, beyond the tomb of Cecilia Metella. We often encountered, in these expeditions, a company of English tourists, with whom I had an ardent, but ungratified longing, to establish a speaking acquaintance. They were one Mr. Davis, and a small circle of friends. It was impossible not to know Mrs. Davis's name, from her being always in great request among her party, and her party being everywhere. During the Holy Week, they were in every part of every scene of every ceremony. For a fortnight or 3 weeks before it, they were in every tomb, and every church, and every ruin, and every picture gallery, and I hardly ever observed Mrs. Davis to be silent for a moment. Deep underground, high up in St. Peter's, out on the Campagna, and stifling in the Jews' Quarter, Mrs. Davis turned up, all the same. I don't think she ever saw anything, or ever looked at anything, and she had always lost something out of a straw hand basket, and was trying to find it, with all her might and main, among an immense quantity of English halfpence, which lay, like sands upon the seashore, at the bottom of it. There was a professional cicerone always attached to the party, which had been brought over from London, 15 or 20 strong, by contract. And if he so much as looked at Mrs. Davis, she invariably cut him short by saying, "There, God bless the man, don't worry at me. I don't understand a word you say, and shouldn't if you was to talk till you was black in the face." Mr. Davis always had a snuff-coloured great coat on, and carried a great green umbrella in his hand, and had a slow curiosity constantly devouring him, which prompted him to do extraordinary things, such as taking the covers off urns in tombs, and looking in at the ashes as if they were pickles, and tracing out inscriptions with the ferrule of his umbrella, and saying, with intense thoughtfulness, "Here's a B you see, and there's a R, and this is the way we goes on in, is it?" His antiquarian habits occasioned his being frequently in the rear of the rest, and one of the agonies of Mrs. Davis, and the party in general, was an ever-present fear that Davis would be lost. This caused them to scream for him, in the strangest places, and at the most improper seasons. And when he came, slowly emerging out of some sepulchre or other, like a peaceful ghoul, saying, "Here I am," Mrs. Davis invariably replied, "You'll be buried alive in a foreign country, Davis, and it's no use trying to prevent you." Mr. and Mrs. Davis, and their party, had, probably, been brought from London in about 9 or 10 days. 1800 years ago, the Roman legions under Claudius protested against being led into Mr. and Mrs. Davis's country, urging that it lay beyond the limits of the world. Among what may be called the cubs or minor lions of Rome, there was one that amused me mightily. It is always to be found there, and its den is on the great flight of steps that lead from the Piazza di Spina to the church of Trinita del Monte. In plainer words, these steps are the great place of resort for the artists' models, and that they are constantly waiting to be hired. The first time I went up there, I could not conceive why the faces seemed familiar to me, why they appeared to have beset me, for years, in every possible variety of action and costume, and how it came to pass that they started up before me, in Rome, in the broad day, like so many saddled and bridled nightmares. I soon found that we had made acquaintance, and improved it, for several years, on the walls of various exhibition galleries. There is one old gentleman, with long white hair and an immense beard, who, to my knowledge, has gone half through the catalogue of the Royal Academy. This is the venerable, or patriarchal model. He carries a long staff, and every knot and twist in that staff I have seen, faithfully delineated, innumerable times. There is another man in a blue cloak, who always pretends to be asleep in the sun, when there is any, and who, I need not say, is always very wide awake, and very attentive to the disposition of his legs. This is the Dolce Far Niente model. There is another man in a brown cloak, who leans against a wall, with his arms folded in his mantle, and looks out of the corners of his eyes, which are just visible beneath his broad slouched hat. This is the assassin model. There is another man, who constantly looks over his own shoulder, and is always going away, but never does. This is the haughty, or scornful model. As to domestic happiness, and holy families, they should come very cheap, for there are lumps of them, all up the steps, and the cream of the thing is, that they are all the falsest vagabonds in the world, especially made up for the purpose, and having no counterparts in Rome or any other part of the habitable globe. My recent mention of the carnival, reminds me of its being said to be a mock mourning, in the ceremony with which it closes, for the gaieties and merrymakings before Lent, and this again reminds me of the real funerals and mourning processions of Rome, which, like those in most other parts of Italy, are rendered chiefly remarkable to a foreigner, by the indifference with which the mere clay is universally regarded, after life has left it. And this is not from the survivors having had time to dissociate the memory of the dead from their well-remembered appearance and form on earth, for the interment follows too speedily after death, for that, almost always taking place within 24 hours, and, sometimes, within 12. At Rome, there is the same arrangement of pits in a great, bleak, open, dreary space, that I have already described as existing in Genoa. When I visited it, at noonday, I saw a solitary coffin of plain deal, uncovered by any shroud or pall, and so slightly made, that the hoof of any wandering mule would have crushed it in, carelessly tumbled down, all on one side, on the door of one of the pits, and the left, by itself, in the wind and sunshine. How does it come to be left here? I asked the man who showed me the place. It was brought here half an hour ago, Signore, he said. I remembered to have met the procession, on its return, straggling away at a good round pace. When will it be put in the pit? I asked him. When the cart comes, and it is open tonight, he said. How much does it cost to be brought here in this way, instead of coming in the cart? I asked him. 10 scudi, he said, about £2, 2 and 6 pence, English. The other bodies, for whom nothing is paid, are taken to the church of the Santa Maria della Consolazione. He continued, and brought here altogether, in the cart at night. I stood, a moment, looking at the coffin, which had 2 initial letters scrawled upon the top, and turned away, with an expression in my face, I suppose, of not much liking its exposure in that manner, for he said, shrugging his shoulders with great vivacity, and giving a pleasant smile, but he's dead, signore, he's dead. Why not? Among the innumerable churches, there is one I must select for separate mention. It is the Church of the Arachili, supposed to be built on the site of the old temple of Jupiter Phaetrius, and approached, on one side, by a long steep flight of steps, which seem incomplete without some group of bearded soothsayers on the top. It is remarkable for the possession of a miraculous bambino, or wooden doll, representing the infant Saviour, and I first saw this miraculous bambino, in legal phrase, in manner following, that is to say. We had strolled into the church one afternoon, and were looking down its long vista of gloomy pillars, for all these ancient churches built upon the ruins of old temples, are dark and sad, when the brave came running in, with a grin upon his face that stretched it from ear to ear, and implored us to follow him, without a moment's delay, as they were going to show the bambino to a select party. We accordingly hurried off to a sort of chapel, or sacristy, hard by the chief altar, but not in the church itself, where the select party, consisting of 2 or 3 Catholic gentlemen and ladies, not Italians, were already assembled, and where one hollow-cheeked young monk was lighting up divers candles, while another was putting on some clerical robes over his coarse brown habit. The candles were on a kind of altar, and above it were 2 delectable figures, such as you would see at any English fair, representing the Holy Virgin, and Saint Joseph, as I suppose, bending in devotion over a wooden box, or coffer, which was shut. The hollow-cheeked monk, number 1, having finished lighting the candles, went down on his knees, in a corner, before this set piece, and the monk number 2, having put on a pair of highly ornamented and gold bespattered gloves, lifted down a coffer, with great reverence, and set it on the altar. Then, with many genuflections, and muttering certain prayers, he opened it, and let down the front, and took off sundry coverings of satin and lace from the inside. The ladies had been on their knees from the commencement, and the gentlemen now dropped down devoutly, as he exposed to view a little wooden doll, in face very like General Tom Thumb, the American dwarf, gorgeously dressed in satin and gold lace, and actually blazing with rich jewels. There was scarcely a spot upon its little breast, or neck, or stomach, but was sparkling with the costly offerings of the faithful. Presently, he lifted it out of the box, and carrying it round among the kneelers, set its face against the forehead of every one, and tendered its clumsy foot to them to kiss, a ceremony which they all performed down to a dirty little ragamuffin of a boy who had walked in from the street. When this was done, he laid it in the box again, and the company, rising, drew near, and commended the jewels in whispers. In good time, he replaced the coverings, shut up the box, put it back in its place, locked up the whole concern, Holy Family and all, behind a pair of folding doors, took off his priestly vestments, and received the customary small charge, while his companion, by means of an extinguisher fastened to the end of a long stick, put out the lights, one after another. The candles being all extinguished, and the money all collected, they retired, and so did the spectators.